So hello and welcome. I'm glad you're here. Happy Friday. Today is Friday, June the 18th, and this is episode number 114 of Backyard Beekeeping Questions and Answers. My name is Frederick Dunn, and this is The Way to Be. So we have a lot to get through today. It is raining outside, of course, and in the desert southwest, they wish they had rain because it's really, really hot out there. 66 degrees Fahrenheit here, 19 degrees Celsius for those of you who follow Celsius. This is also available on Podbean, so if you're following me on Podbean, thank you for being here. And it is also titled The Way to Be, and you can visit the website, thewaytobe.org. So I'm glad you're here. What else do we have to talk about? Let's just jump right in. These are questions submitted during the past week. Comments right on YouTube themselves or via the form filled out on my main website, or some of them come from Facebook and elsewhere. So the first one's from Garrett Bruce. I'm still acquiring the necessary equipment to keep bees beginning next year. I just ordered acorn frames, deeps, and mediums for both of my 10-frame hives. So hives come in 8 or 10 frame. I was thinking about purchasing a couple of additional frames to harvest chunk honey. I know you can purchase Ross round frames, but I was wondering what the process would be like to set up traditional frames when wanting to harvest chunk honey. Do you need some sort of foundation? What kind of frames should you use, as always? Thanks for your time. Well, here's the thing. I think if you've been watching my channel, then you already know that I use Ross rounds. And really good luck with them. And that's a very easy way to go. But of course, you have to buy the foundation, you have to buy the plastic, you have to buy all the other stuff, but you get to use it over and over again. So the initial investment, once that's out of the way, you can make comb honey. And so there are hog halves, and there are Ross rounds, and then there's just plain cut comb. And I think that's what we're talking about here. So I'm going to make a very basic suggestion about that. You only want to put these on your strongest hives, the hives that are really built up with lots of bees on them, and they already have full medium supers on. Then as you're going into that nectar flow, while things are going really strong, I highly recommend you put in shallow supers on top of the hives that you've picked for that purpose. Use wooden frames. So those are wooden foundationless frames. So no, you do not have to buy foundation. This, of course, is a deep frame, which, by the way, would take them a huge amount of effort to fill out. That's why I'm recommending a shallow super and then the shallow frames that go with it. They'll only be about this tall. And that's convenient because once they draw out all the comb and they make it and they cover it, as I know they will, front and back, they're going to draw out all the comb and they're going to cap it. Then there are pre-shaped square cutters for cut comb that you can buy, or you can go really old school and just get a really sharp knife and cut out your chunks and be very cheap and put them right into Ziploc baggies and things like that. Now here's the thing too. When you cut the comb, you're cutting through some of the cells. It's unavoidable. So what happens is cut comb that you do by yourself, people say, will granulate earlier than something that the bees seal up themselves like this Ross round. So that's another thing to think about. You can just put them in Ziploc baggies. What's the next step, though? After you do that, don't forget to put them through a cycle of freezing. So put them in your deep freeze. And that just makes sure there's no chance that any eggs were laid in the honeycomb and things like that by those dreaded wax moths trying to get their larvae going. So anyway, put that through a freeze cycle and you're good to go. You got it. Cut comb. Ready to go. Super easy. Not every colony will do it. Last year, we had 3 colonies that made full supers that did a fantastic job on the Ross rounds. I did a video about it. I may link that down below, or you can just search for it. Question number 2, Mark Wars 22. Once again, impressed and perplexed by the behavior of my honeybees. I did a full inspection today. A few days after having finally gained control of robbing that had been going on for about a week. It's a long time for robbing to take place. Using a B-Smart gate. What the heck is a B-Smart gate? So that's right here. This is the B-Smart Designs robbing screen, it's called, and it has little openings in the top. We've done videos about it, but I just wanted to give you a quick visual. That's what those are. I was surprised to find the bees actively feeding a queen cell in the middle of the frame. Supercedure? Question mark. I'd guess around day five or six, and a capped queen cell near the bottom of the frame, but not hanging from the bottom. Swarm cell? Question mark. Identified the queen, and she looked fine, and I didn't notice any harassment by workers. Eggs visualized, but appreciably less than previous checks, and notably more empty brood cells. Lots of unkept larvae and a fair amount of capped brood. Healthy amount of drones and resources, mite count zero last week. Any guesses if this represents preparations for supercedure or swarming or both? I'm seeing less brood, but still a good four frames full in the bottom box. Upper box is still only partially drawn with three frames of honey thus far. So, should they have plenty of room? They should have plenty of room. I squished the closed queen cell at the bottom to give myself more time, but left the middle frame queen cell intact. Okay, and that's why I wanted to answer this question in particular. If you're looking at, first of all, the colony is making preparations to swarm. There's no question, because they've built those cells. So they've got a queen cell and a supercedure cell. So they're planning both. So that tells you two things. One, they had the time to plan and build the full-size swarm cells, which are along the fringes of the frames as described here. And then they also may be unhappy with the current condition of the queen, the way she's laying or something else. So they built supercedure cells, which are right in the middle of the field of a brood frame. So we have both going on, but guess what? Which of those two locations would the bees have been producing the largest, healthiest, most robust replacement queens? Not in the supercedure cell, not in the supercedure cell in the middle, but rather along that periphery with those big queen cells. In my opinion, I think you smush the best queen and you cap the inferior queen, because one was built on an emergency because it came from a normal worker cell in the middle of the field, and another was built specifically for a queen, usually started as a queen cup. So see the difference? They would have really fed her well, the egg would have been laid, and they would have known that they were developing her as a queen from day one by overloading her with copious amounts of royal jelly. They just keep feeding, and so I think it's much the wrong one. Anyway, they're going to swarm. So you've saved that. But another thing, too, we found the queen. So this is a great opportunity. If you see that queen and you see queen cells, it is a great opportunity to nab the queen and go ahead and put her in a new hive box and then pull frames of this brood that we're talking about. Then you could leave the queen cells in the resident colony, because now you've created an artificial swarm. We took the queen away that they were rejecting anyway by the supercedure cell, and they were preparing to swarm by the swarm cells. So with any luck, there might actually be other swarm cells in the colony. But I would catch the queen, pull her out, pull some brood frames, and put her in a new box and start a new colony with her. That way we've satisfied the need to swarm. We've left behind the resources for them to replace her, because we've already got capped queens. If you've got capped queen cells, so we know they're going to hatch within the next 5 days. And then we've got a jump on things for replacing her. So that's what I would have done, taken that queen out of there, started a new colony. Even though it seemed like they had plenty of space for reasons known only to the bees, they were getting rid of their queen and they were going to supersede, replace, push her out. And we don't always see them chasing the queen around. Even though she's supposed to be losing weight, that's why they continue to allow her to lay eggs, which is actually a great survival tool, and why we still may have eggs and open larvae in a hive, even though they're making preparations to swarm. I see this over and over again in the observation hive. The queen lays right up until 2 or 3 days before she heads out of there, and then we have brand new open larvae in there, but there's always the queen cells, so we don't care about the open 24-hour-old freshly hatched eggs that they would need to make an emergency queen. So now they're good to go, but just for future reference, I personally would, if you're smushing any of the queen cells, I would smush the supercedure cells in the middle of the frames and show favor to those that are along the periphery that are much larger and more developed, and from the time an egg was laid, treated like queens. Next question, number 3. William Smith, Suffolk, Virginia. Our local crop duster lets you know the night before he sprays, so we can close up our hives. The farm is across the street. Lately, because of the heat, they are bearding on the front and the back and underneath the hives. They're not going in even after dark. How do I get them back into the hive so I can keep them safe from the farmer's spraying? There's a couple of things that some people do. Some people break out their smoker and smoke the outside of the hive when it's cool at night and drive all the bees in, and then they close it up. But there are screens, there's bags for beehives that you can put over the top of the hive that even though they're bearding and things like that, it's just like a giant pillowcase that's usually for transporting beehives. They sell them, Daydont, Betterbee, Manlake, all these companies will sell them. And I'll probably put a link down below for you if you want to see what those are like. But you would put those on the night before, of course, once all the bees were in. And that way they can still be on the front. You don't have to drive them in. You don't have to smoke them. You don't have to stress them. And that would profoundly cut down the number of bees. You can also just drape your hive with screen cloth that's designed to keep the bees from getting through. A lot of truckers that ship their bees around put these big screens around the entire load. But you can do it around independent hives as well. The other thing is, I'm saying it's great that a crop duster is letting you know that they're going to spray, because a lot of them don't. Farmers won't even talk about when they're going to do what, because they just do it in the rhythm of when the weather allows it and what they need to do when. But you might want to find out what they're actually spraying and what the risks are and what else is going on in the environment where you live that the bees will be foraging on, because the threat may not be as big as you're thinking. The other thing is, what time of day are they going to be doing the crop dusting? Mid-afternoon or early morning, for example? So the risks overall could be pretty low. But find out what they're spraying and what the actual risks are. And depending on what the crop is, your bees may not be touching it anyway. We certainly don't want that to happen on a windy day, but that's not effective for the crop duster either, to have what they're spraying blown off of the target species of plant that they're supposed to be spraying. So anyway, that's it. There's a bag that you can put over it. They work really good, and people use them all the time. And then once things are dry, so you don't have to keep them on for like 24 hours, just until midday or after the spray is dry on the crops. You don't want them directly spraying your bees, but learn more about what's being spread and do your research on that. Question number 4, Berry Parish, Oakland, California. Last inspection 2 weeks ago, disappointed that I could not find my queen, but lots of brood in various stages, so it appeared queen right. Queen right means that there's a queen there, eggs, larvae, all stages, everything looks in harmony. Today I found her on second frame, but no eggs. No young brood, hardly any drone brood, no queen cells, and almost all capped brood hatched out. I mark the queen with a one-hand queen catcher. Always have some kind of cage. This is my little homemade one. If you come across a queen and she's not marked, you can pop this open with one hand. You can put her right in there and mark her this year with your white marking pen, with your paint pen, and then you'll be able to spot her quicker later. But always have your queen cage handy. It was nerve-wracking, but it was successful. And it was the first time. What the heck is going on? Is this a supercedure queen? Is there normally a lag in brood when this happens? And lastly, if this is a natural brood break, should I consider an OA treatment now, or would that risk hurting my new queen if she's new? So there are a couple things going on. First of all, where are we located? This is Oakland, California. So right now, California is in a superheated dearth, so to speak. So it is not uncommon. A lot of different bee lines, bee stock, behaves differently to weather situations and dearth situations. For example, Russian bees would pull off of laying eggs as soon as there's a dearth. As soon as new resources are not coming through the hive entry anymore, she would simply stop laying eggs and therefore reduce the demand for resources inside the hive. And then again, once a new nectar flow comes back into play, and there's new resources coming in, she begins to lay again. Now, for a lot of people, that doesn't work, but it might be the bees that you have, and they may actually have gone into a cessation of laying eggs just until the resources start to provide again. So look into what's going on environmentally, especially with the absence of any other evidence that they're preparing to swarm. Another option is that they already did swarm just before this, and that you actually have a virgin queen that has not begun to lay yet, that hasn't been mated, things like that. But given the current weather conditions across the United States, Desert Southwest, and the West Coast, I would guess that you're probably in a dearth and they probably have slowed down, if not stopped, egg laying just for now. So the second part of that question is, should you treat for varroa mites while there's no brood? Well, only if there's evidence that the varroa mites are present to begin with. This is a funny year for me because I keep pulling the trays underneath my hives and looking for mites. I found one this morning out of all the hives I'm looking at. And so we're low on mites this year. I don't know what your mite counts are there, but before considering a treatment, and yes, it would be opportune if there's no sealed brood in your hive. You also, you just want to be aware of what's going on elsewhere and what the other contributing factors would be, and do a mite count first. Don't just do it because it's convenient and the opportunity presents itself. Know the mite load. So how many of you are also not seeing a lot of mites this year? It's pretty weird. Pretty weird in a good way. Question number 5, Mr. B, Blaine, Washington. Looking at building a Layens hive. Layens hive. This is a Layens hive. That's what a Layens hive looks like. But I see multiple options for sizes. For example, the Leo Sherishkin's original is 14 frames, while his insulated, which is the one I have, the insulated version, is 20 frames. He says the Layens hives can be anywhere from 20 to 30 frames. So any guidance on what size I should make mine would be greatly appreciated. My situation is I have a small garden plot, would like 2 colonies, don't mind if they swarm or produce little honey. Well, that's good that you have no expectations from your bees, but there's a very good book if you don't have it already. It's about the Layens. It's about the Layens hive. Dr. Leo Sherishkin edited that so that it could be transposed into English, translated into English. Anyway, I recommend you get that book because it talks about all those principles, but here's the other part of it. The one I have holds 20 frames, a very good brand new colony of bees. If there's no foundation on the frames inside a beehive, the average is that they could only max out 20 Langstroth deep frames in a year if they had to pull out all the comb on their own without any foundation. So you're probably pretty good because the Layens frames are much larger than the Langstroth deep frames. So 20 frames is more than enough, especially based on your description of what you want to do and your expectations are low. But since you're building it yourself, you can make it like my long Langstroth hive is built for about 33 frames. And I know they're never going to fill it. But here's the beauty of a horizontal hive. You have a follower board. Some people also call it a divider board. So when you set up your first 5 or 6 frames in there, when you're setting up a brand new colony, you put the divider board in there. All the bees that are occupying the hive know is the space that you've provided for them. They don't even realize that more than half of the space is still available beyond that board. So this gives you an opportunity to store your gear in there, first of all, which I like to do. The other thing is you simply move the divider board over and install new fresh frames as your colony expands and needs more space and resources. So there's nothing wrong with making it beyond a 30 frame. Because you're building it yourself. Since I wanted to review Dr. Leo Sherishkin's premium, his best hive, it's the insulated one with lamb's wool and everything else in it, and it holds 20 frames. So, that's it. The bees don't know if there's more space or not. It's up to you. Use a divider board and build it as big as you like. Bigger is better, I think, in this circumstance. So that's it for number 5. Question number 6. Nathaniel from Kansas City, Missouri. Everything's up to date in Kansas City. I was born north of Kansas City, Missouri, in the town of Maryville, Northwest Missouri State College, which is now Northwest Missouri State University. My hope is to help develop strong enough hives to eventually be also able to harvest and sell the honey and beeswax. I've seen a lot of videos from your channel, among others, about the flow hive. And I have never heard anyone bring up the inability to harvest any wax from them. Isn't beeswax also a desired commodity from a hive? Or am I overestimating its value? And for keepers who do harvest wax, how do they? Can they apply a flow hive into their apiary? Okay, well, let's talk about the flow hive a little bit. The purpose of the flow hive is to make the demand for wax production as reduced as possible for the bees, because the more wax they produce, the less honey they produce, because it's a direct correlation. If they already have infrastructure, that's why they already have the cells, but they're mechanized and allow them to drain off honey without cutting out all the beeswax, without uncapping. The bees recycle and reuse the cap wax that's on there to a degree. Some of it they dispense with when it gets old, but that is the whole purpose of the Flow Super, is to have the lowest impact on the bees, drain the honey out with no post-processing, so you're not collecting. See, in the normal process, it's a comparison right here. So you've got the Flow Hive, you're not going through uncapping, you're not cutting the frames, you're not removing them and putting them into an extractor. So normally we would be collecting all the cap wax and you end up filling huge bins with it. So the cap wax is what a lot of people want to use and what they want to sell, and they make cakes out of it, cakes of wax. You know, like this stuff right here. And this is a really thin one, but this is, I marked it with the weight, this is 1.4 pounds or something. So I get several pounds of beeswax just through the normal trimmings and stuff when I'm inspecting colonies. That's what that comes from. So the Flow Hive, if you're looking for wax as part of your harvesting practices, then the Flow Hive is not your best choice for that. You want to go standard. In fact, if you really want to harvest wax, the best way to do that too is when you're deconstructing a colony that failed, that died out. So dead outs are good sources for beeswax. You have to cut it all out anyway. So you're going to get rid of it. So you're going to have an opportunity to filter out all the wax that's in there, scrape it all off, and then you end up with lots of beeswax. But I would say that the honey market is stronger than the wax market. So if you're getting honey and you're selling that right now in the state of Pennsylvania where I live, it's $20 a quart. That's pretty darn good, $80 a gallon. And so the market for wax is very inconsistent and in what people want to do with it. And they're always bargain shoppers too, because there's a lot of people, commercial beekeepers, that are selling huge quantities of wax. So, but for the Flow Hive, that's not your hive for collecting wax. But if you have a lot of hives and you're doing routine inspections, you're scraping away burr comb and things like that, that's why I always have a bucket or a container sitting there to collect my burr comb in. And then I render that later. So, but yeah, you probably want to go traditional if wax is what your target is. And so what you do is you look up, what does it sell for? Who wants it? Do you have a client to buy it? Or are you just going to end up with a whole bunch of wax on the shelf? See what I mean? So it might not be as much of a gain as you think, but the Flow Hive is not your hive if you're after wax. Next question, number 7. RP from Smithville, Mississippi. Is it okay to inspect a hive that is bearding? Bearding is when your bees are on the outside of the hive and they're all collected on lining board and everything else. These are foragers. I haven't been able to check my hives in 2 weeks because of rain and work. Tomorrow is supposed to be sunny, so I would like to inspect. I know they may not be bearding tomorrow, but just in case they are bearding, should I inspect or not? And the thing is, yeah, you can inspect a colony that's got bees bearding on the front. You just won't, you know, interrupt the areas where they're collected. So as they, hopefully they're bearding on the landing board, and on my hives, we have the hive visors on the front. So when they collect on the front, they just cluster underneath the hive visor. So every box above that, sure, that's open for inspection because you're not going to mess with those bees anyway. And bonus, they're hanging out on the front or the bottom of the hive instead of inside the hive where you need to see what's going on. So it's good all the way around. The bees aren't involved in what you're doing and you're not messing with the bees. So then when you're looking at your frames, you have a much clearer view of the brood and all the stuff that you need to see because these foragers are out of the way. Why are they on the front anyway? They have to get out of the way so the interior of the hive can ventilate. Especially during a nectar flow, you see a lot of bearding going on because inside the hive, all the bees are working to fan the air across that and dehydrate the nectar that's in those cells so they can cap it off and make honey. And these foragers, to be honest, are just in the way. They contribute heat, respiration, moisture, everything is in there. And so by moving them outside, you start to help relieve some of that congestion. So it's actually beneficial for inspection. So yeah, take a look. Get right in there. Question number 8, George Garcia. I have flow frames over a regular brood box. I was wondering what happens to bees that are producing wax from their wax glands if they can't have a way of using the wax. Do they throw out the wax flakes? I suppose they can use it for wax capping of the flow frames if they have a place to place the nectar. Does it slow the production of their wax glands? Yes, this is in response to the need for infrastructure inside the hive. So if they don't need any more beeswax, if they don't need any more comb, if they don't need any more cells, if they don't need to expand the infrastructure, then they simply don't produce new scales of wax. So they just don't do it. They turn off and on their wax glands as necessary. So it's not like it's coming out no matter what, and now we have to do something with it. So yeah, it's just based on how it's needed. And then if they're not making wax, what are they doing? They're making more honey. So that's pretty good. Yep, they just respond to it. So here's a question that deals with the cover shot of today's video. And that is, this comes up a lot, but I got this email today. I have a customer named, that I won't name because email's about them, not from them, in Ohio that's having a bunch of trouble with his bees taking to his flow frames. He's not new to beekeeping and has tried numerous different strategies for them to use the flow frames, but has not yet experienced any success. He's currently in the mindset that flow frames aren't compatible in colder climates. Well, so the other thing is we need to work that out before we even buy them, because let's be honest, they're expensive. Flow frames, flow hives, flow everything is expensive, and that's why I held this up at the beginning for this video. The thing is, this question comes up in forums a lot, and I don't visit a lot of forums because they tend to be dominated by just a handful of people, and newcomers with their information and advice just frankly aren't welcome. It becomes pretty obvious. So I'm going to use my platform to talk a little bit about the flow frame. So this is what a flow frame looks like. And these parts need to be able to move, but you'll notice that the leading edges are uneven, and this whole thing is made out of food grade plastic. And the bees have to seal up the joints. They form hexagonal cells, and when it's in the closed position, the cells are all together. They're at a slight slant, just as they are in a normally drawn out cell. The cells are big. The cells are deep. So they're designed just for the bees to store their honey in there. But before that can happen, the bees have to seal up those crevices and their joints. And this is the point of frustration for a lot of people. And then you'll find out that people will be saying in the forums, spray it with sugar water. They took right to it and it just worked fantastic. Oh, I, you know, sprayed mine with wax and they took to it and that just made them go great. And then somebody else comments, did that didn't work. So here's the thing, where is your flow super going to go in the first place? It should not be going on a hive that is not already booming and showing a lot of progress in wax and honey production, because you're wasting your time if you put them on those colonies. So my flow frames only go on half of my colonies in a given year. So when we put them out there, we're putting them on the strongest colonies that are already showing. You pull that inner cover on that hive and you're doing your inspection, the entire surface of that inner cover's got burr comb all over it and they're putting honey and everything in it, candidate for your flow hive right there. Now here's the other thing, and this is where I do something that is super risky, because what's my configuration? Well, I use the deep brood box. 10 frame is better than 8 because that means you have more bees. And then I put the medium super on there and then I let them fill that out. And when that thing is wall-to-wall, 8 out of the 10 frames are wall-to-wall capped honey and it's nice and heavy and the bees are going gangbusters in there, the very next box on there is going to be the flow super. Now here's also where I depart from what even the manufacturer recommends. What do I do to prepare these frames for the bees to start working them? They don't do anything. I know. It doesn't make any sense. I take them right out of the box they come in. If, of course, now I'm using them year after year because I've been using these. My first year of getting honey from a flow super was 2016. So the ones that are used obviously go to work on them much quicker. But the brand new ones, I don't do any preps. I just put it on there and I do not put the queen excluder on there. So that's something that goes against the manufacturer. The manufacturer obviously doesn't want there to be any eggs being laid up inside your flow super. Neither do I. I don't want that. That's why we have the honey bridge first. I don't have any upper venting. I don't have any upper entrance. Not anymore. So what happens is the brood, hopefully, in a perfect world, the brood stays down in that bottom box, maybe a little bit up into that medium super, and then I don't have a queen excluder above that, and then the bees can go freely up into that flow super because they're looking for places to put their honey. So look at this Ross round right here. That's a man-made plastic circle in a plastic rack on a shallow super that sits on top of a hive, and the bees just get in there and they build it out inside these plastic rings. That's man-made stuff. The bees just made use of space that was available, so they didn't care what it was composed of. So the flow super is the same thing. If we give them free access to it, they're looking for places to, first of all, seal up every little crack that they can find, and that's what they do first. That's why we see them all over the place. They're not really putting honey or nectar in there yet because we've got these moving parts. And the bees have to seal up these joints first, and those joints are actually pretty open so that they don't injure the bees when they cycle. The other thing is the leading edge of the joints. Maybe I can get a good raking shot across here, but if you look at the leading edge, the way the top is, they're at different heights. So the bees also have to draw out wax until they get a nice even surface there. I hope that was in focus. But anyway, and I have found that this happens super fast if there's no queen excluder. But Fred, what happens if you told me to do that? Now they get up in there, and now the queen went and laid some eggs up in there. Now what are we supposed to do? Well, they still worked those flow frames, didn't they, when the queen went up there and deposited her eggs in those illegal locations. And then when the queen moves back down below, and you see her, that's key, and you see her down there, then put your queen excluder in. See? So after they've sealed it up, after they've showed interest, after they've invested infrastructure work up there, and those wax workers, those unemployed wax workers we talked about earlier, once they're up there and they're sealing everything up and doing everything great, they're invested. Now when the queen excluder goes in, they zip right up there and keep right on working. What kind of queen excluder do I recommend? I actually don't recommend the plastic one that comes with your flow hive. I recommend these metal queen excluders with the wooden frames around them because the joints are nice and snug when you put the boxes together, and it's obvious from a distance which of the hives have the queen excluders in and which ones don't, and they seem to work out really well. So start them, and again, this is a total risk. You can end up with eggs in your flow super. It normally doesn't happen, but I have to say that it could. But go without the queen excluder. Don't even bother treating or prepping or putting wax or spraying your comb. I mean, you can spray sugar water in there if you want to. The bees are just going to clean it up. But they will build them out. I've never primed any of my frames, and every single flow hive I put on now works. But why? Because I picked a strong colony, and evidence that they were looking to build wax and expand their resources was already there. Then I put it on. If I've got a colony that's not doing all of that stuff and I put a flow super on there, it's not going to magically make them capable of producing more wax and storing honey. So that is my answer to that question. And that's to all of you who are trying. Test it out. Queen excluders slow everything down so much that to me, it is worth the risk of having one lay an egg. And what's the other caveat? What else can you not have in your upper box above that? No venting, no upper entrance. When you do that, there is an encouragement for the queen to get up there and start laying some eggs. So we want to keep everything down near the vented entrance. Question number 10, Jesse Aldridge, Heath, Texas. First time beekeeper, got my first hive a month and a half ago, really trying to do my best to keep my hive thriving. I plan to get a second hive, but my real question is, how can I manage just two hives? I don't want to do splits or increase my apiary more than two hives. How and maintain just two hives? How can I do that, get honey, and enjoy my bees? I don't want a lot of excessive equipment, etc. I am limited in space. I've watched most of your podcast, And this is a great dilemma. Okay. Well, this is one of the great misunderstandings about beekeeping is you get a couple of hives, and there was a member of my beekeeping club. I was like, nobody told me I was going to need an entire woodshed just to keep all of my related beekeeping equipment. It seems to me that the amount of equipment that we have outside of the apiary is equal to or greater than the equipment that we have out in the apiary. It just kind of snowballs as the years go by. So you want to keep it to just two hives, and you don't want to get into splits and things like that. So one of the things I recommend to everyone, especially if you're new to beekeeping, you need a mentor. So a real in-person mentor. I mean, I'm glad you're here listening or watching. I think that's great because it can get the wheels turning, but nothing beats a person in person, right there with you, looking at your stuff. But here's another reason. You want to join a bee club because it means there's other beekeepers there, and there is always someone that wants a queen. There's always someone that wants another colony. There's someone that lost a colony and wants to replace it. So rather than be concerned about constraining the bees and hoping that they don't swarm, that they don't reproduce, which is what their biology is demanding that they do. See, we're working against their biology to keep them at just a single colony, never to reproduce. So if you have a fellowship, if you've got a bunch of beekeeper friends that you can reach out to, maybe a Facebook group, then when it looks like things are building up, you can say, hey, somebody want to come and get a split from my hive. And that way you can keep things healthy. When you're doing an inspection, and hopefully you're doing an inspection roughly every 2 weeks. So every 14 days is a pretty good benchmark. So when you're looking at your hive and you say, oh no, they're making those queen cells. Oh, they're doing a supercedure cell. Oh, there's too many bees in there. That's when you call up one of your friends and say, come on over and take some of my bees for me, right? If they're already making queen cells and things like that, what are you going to have to do? You're going to have to pull the queen that's in there because they're starting to get rid of her. That's, again, where another friend comes into play. And now we have a natural brood split while we wait for the new queens to hatch and for them to establish themselves. They have to do mating flights and things like that. So then you've got a brood break, which is varroa control, natural varroa control, and you did not expand your colonies. So there you go. A fellowship. Somebody benefits from what you have and don't need. And what they need, of course, and you have. So, but I will tell other people, you might want to keep like a nucleus hive on hot standby, a really good one. Not one of those corrugated ones, not OSB, not these cheap ones that aren't meant to last forever and ever. Get a really good 5-frame nucleus box. You can get them from Betterbee, Dedant, Man Lake, everybody makes them. Oh. That's one right there. That is a pine nucleus box. In the past, I haven't used them because when I catch a swarm or something like that, I like to put them right into the finished box. But this year, because I'm trying to hang on to all my bees, I'm trying to keep them around, I'm trying to keep resources. So when I find a condition, when I look in the hive and they're making queen cells and things like that, and I spot the queen and she's scooting around, I catch the queen. Don't forget, whatever your little queen cage is. And I pull a couple of frames of brood out of there, and I leave the queen cells in the original hive, and I start one of these nucleus colonies, and I put her in there. And she's laying already. She's laying right away. And there we go. I've got a resource colony. Now, when one of these new queens hatches out, and she goes to do her mating flight, and she never comes back, something bad happened to her. Some bee ate her. Some kid shot her with a slingshot. Who knows what happens? Then you go back and look, and there's no eggs, and there's no queen. What do I do? Oh, wait. I have a queen in my nucleus colony over here. But Fred, what happens to that nucleus that she just started? She's got eggs, she's got brood, she's got everything in there. 2 or 3 frames, it's tiny, but it's hers. Well, then I just kidnap the queen and I bring her back to the original colony and I release her right back in there and she goes right back to egg laying because now what's happened? The stress of them wanting to replace the queen because they had too much population or whatever is gone. And now she's laying eggs again and they think she's new and they're all excited because they've been queenless. And what just happened over there in your little nucleus colony that you left behind? Well, there's eggs in there and there's resources and there's pollen stored. And so what do? They're going to make a queen now. So look what we just did. We created a resource colony. We saved our queen. We saved a colony that otherwise would have been queenless and we had no downtime and no shipping, no expense, except for the cost of one of those little supers, little nucleus colonies. So look at how it just cycles back and forth, and then you got that great resource. But if you are hard and fast and you only want two colonies, you want nothing else, not even a little nucleus colony next to your garden gnome that would look really awesome, and people would say, what's with that tiny beehive? And you could show how much you know about the biology of the bees and how you use it against them to guarantee that you would always have a resource to replace your colony should they become queenless, and you relieve them from the desire to get rid of their queen and started this little resource. Or join a bee club and give it away. That's what I say. Oh, got a message today. A lot of people have been trying to get the bee weaver queens, because if I need a queen, let's say I didn't have one in the nucleus, let's say something devastating happened and I needed to buy one in and fly one in right away, bee weaver in Texas, they have their bee weaver queen stock back in stock, and they can get those. So I thought I would let you know that for those who are queenless and need one, and did not do anything to provide themselves with a safety net in the form of nucleus colonies and things like that. So here is question number 12, Bob Gaskins from Ohio. Let's see, in northwestern Ohio, we caught our first official feral swarm, not from our own apiary, in a maple tree in which I set a trap 10 feet high. We waited until dusk to transfer a single deep about 100 feet from where the trap was, which is where our apiary is located. Everything seemed to go smoothly, although I did not observe the queen during the transfer, but the bees were fanning the entrance, and the next morning I noticed a small cluster of bees in a hollow tree knot, which was right below where the trap was, with lots of bees fanning. And when we say fanning, we want to look to make sure that they've got their little hind ends in the air and that Nasenoff gland is exposed, and they're putting the Nasenoff pheromone out, which is known as the queen mandibular pheromone, the queen's pheromone, to keep everybody cohesive so they're around the correct queen. And I'm going to get to that in a minute. Things seem okay at the new hive location, and I didn't want to inspect them to see if the queen was there until at least a week had passed. Anyway, I tried brushing the small cluster into a pillowcase and even with my gloved hand, but I can't get them in the stinking hole. The thinking is, I don't know if these are foragers that were out when I moved the trap or if the queen was in that hole. Any suggestions? Thanks. Okay, so here's the thing. This is queen biology, and this is fun. This is fun when it comes to swarms. Why did they swarm? They swarm because they're replacing the queen in the original colony. Who do they swarm around? They swarm around the queen. So it can be a laying queen. It can be a virgin queen that hatches from one of those many queen cells. She could hatch and they might not even like her and she might leave. And then a small cluster of workers will go with her. So you have the potential at the time of a swarm for there to be more than one swarm emitting at the same time or in very close proximity to one another, and also to have more than one queen. Because this is something that I've done through the years and made a video about it, how to control a swarm, because as the queen goes, so goes the swarm, as they say. So if you can reach in there and get a hold of a queen from a swarm, guess what those worker bees do? Well, they start getting nuts because they can't find the queen. They start looking all over the place. The surface becomes active. They go from their tight cluster, kind of quiet state, to being super animated. They can't locate that queen. They can't locate her pheromone. Where do they go? They go back where they came from. So, and the reason I bring that up is, it's true too, if you collect a swarm and there's no queen in the box or the hive that you put them in, they're going to search around for her. Sure, they're going to fan a little bit of the entrance, but you're also going to see a lot of bees going out and coming in, going out and coming in, because they're looking all over for her. In the absence of the queen, unless you've moved them somewhere completely unfamiliar, they're going to abscond. They're going to depart in the box that you put them in, and they're going to go back where they came from, or they're going to go in search of the queen. So here's what I suspect has happened. First of all, I think the box that you have that initial swarm in, because they're fanning at the entrance and they're staying in the box, I think you actually have the queen in there. Because otherwise, they'd be searching all over the place for her, and they'd be all scattered, and they would ultimately depart the box, because they have no reason to stay there. Biologically, they're doomed if they show up somewhere and they don't have their reproductive source, which is the queen. That's the whole purpose of the swarm. So then this knot hole that we're talking about, where they're fanning and collected there too, guess what I suspect about that? Could be wrong. I mean, these are just educated guesses. But I think you've got another queen in there. So I think that you have a second location with a small, probably virgin queen based on the size of the colony of bees that are clustered around her there. But they're fanning and they're attending to that, because if they just stuck on the tree, because it is common that the foragers, the scouts that are coming back after they've been looking for something and they find the swarm is gone, they sometimes do cluster where the queen's pheromone still exists on the surface of the tree, tree branch, bark, wherever it is. But that ultimately dissipates, and usually within 24 hours, they leave and they go back to their original colony. So I suspect there is a tiny cluster around a virgin queen, and the reason the virgin queens don't have the same drawing power that the mated laying productive queens do. So that's why you end up with these little fist-sized clusters of bees, which I did collect one this year just for kicks and giggles. They're doing great. So I put them in one of those little nucleus boxes that I got from Betterbee. So I suspect two colonies. Please keep us updated though, Bob, because I want to know if I'm right. I want to know if you really have the queen in there, and I think you do. And I think the other one is a queen also. So ultimately, you know, good luck with those. Number 13 is our last question of the day already. Mike Roth from Caribou, British Columbia, Canada. When should I remove the entrance reducer from my hive? Should I make a half-size reducer? I asked Professor Google, but got so many opposing opinions, I'm not sure what to do. Okay, so this is pretty easy. I've done lots of entrance board tests and stuff. So I'm going to show you this. If you've got a brand new colony of bees and you're just starting them off and it's not a large colony, then this little entrance right here, and I marked the sizes that worked out well, that is a 1 inch by 1/2 inch. The other thing is, I've noticed that if you go to a 3/8 inch by 3 inch wide opening, almost any size colony can handle that and defend it. So this is something that you also will observe. Are your bees able to police that entrance adequately? So if other bees, if they're being stressed by wasps and things like that, or other things getting in there, then you may have to reduce that entrance to a 1 inch by 1/2 inch entrance just to get them going until their numbers are up, until they're solid and strong and defending it. Then for me, the maximum size colony doesn't even need an entrance much wider than 3 inches and then 3/8 of an inch in height. And where I live, that's because we have deer mice. Adult deer mice can't get into those 3/8 inch openings. So that's actually a good start for that. The other thing is, should I make a half size reducer? And the other thing is, you have to open that all the way up, like when summertime comes. Well, only again if the bees are showing too much congestion at the entrance, if there's a lot of fanning and they're having a hard time venting the hive. But when you look at these feral colonies of bees, this is always my guide to see what the bees are doing. And I highly recommend you read Dr. Thomas Seeley's books about honeybee biology, because the size of that entrance in feral colonies remains the same no matter how big the colony is. So it's not like we get it in our heads that we want to open the entire front of the hive when you have a super colony. I used to do it. I love seeing that Grand Central Station. They're just coming and going like crazy. But then I found out that the bees actually have to deploy far fewer guard bees, that their chances of getting raided or robbed are profoundly reduced with the size of the entrance being reduced. And of course, the robbing thing this year is being completely put off by this hive gate, H-Y-F-E-G-A-T-E. You want to look that up, because I've been putting this on new young starter colonies just to see if they could defend themselves. And again, they've got this very narrow height, which means even the European hornets can't get in there, and definitely the Asian giant hornets can't get in there. And one of the things I observed this past week, which is super annoying to me, I was watching a really strong colony of bees that I have. They have lots of guards on deck. Everything looked good. And the biggest bumblebee ever landed on the landing board. And I thought, oh, battle royal, they're going to run that thing off. That bumblebee scooted right past the guards, went right into the side of the colony, And I sat there for 15 minutes waiting for them to run that bumblebee back out onto the landing board, and they did not. So the bumblebees, the big gluttons, are getting in there and getting the nectar, and then they're getting away because they must have done it so often they're smelling like the bees, and the guards are giving them a pass. Well, if you put something like this on there, bumblebees are not getting in through a hive gate. And the other thing is, we've had really hot weather recently, and the hives that these are on are venting just fine. You have the ability to put two of these on a hive. I only have one. Hive inspections are great. Everything looks good. Zero robbing. So there's two robbing things. There's a robbing screen, Bee Smart Designs. Everybody's seen those before. New this year, this hive gate entrance, which is a channel. That's working fantastic. I'm really impressed, and other people that are using it are giving nothing but positive responses. So that's it. Now we're just shooting the breeze. We're at the end. We finished all the questions. So I wanted to talk to you a little bit about, because I teach about bees, I share about bees, I talk about bees. One of the biggest things when you're talking to groups about honeybees are visuals. So now when I do my hive inspections, I'm setting up these full camera rigs and I'm doing high definition photography of the frames. Why would you do that? Well, for one, it's a great way to document an inspection to see what the status of a hive was and what was going on. But here's what occurred to me. I'm actually getting an opportunity to photograph frames where everything is present in one image. So I decided to make these educational posters. Now, a standard educational poster would have a lot of parameters written on it. Some of them are kind of illustrations, like cartoon illustrations, and they talk about the cycle of the bee, egg, larvae, capped pupae, you know, adult bee, drones, queens, all that stuff. This isn't that. These are photographs that are 24 by 32 inches, so these are poster sized, and it just shows the conditions in the hive. And this leaves you or me, the speaker, the presenter, the opportunity to have someone look at an image and say, what do you see here? What do you notice? Do you see the queen on that image? Do you see drones? What do they look like? So especially because I have my junior beekeepers, right? So they have bee suits and everything else, 5 and 6 years old. And showing them a picture and challenging them to find out what's going on there. What do they see? You see eggs? Do they look good? Oh, there's two eggs in that cell. What could be going on there? Why do you think that happens? Look at this picture right here. Is that, what is that? Oh, that's pollen. Why is it different colors? So it engages your students. So if they're young or old. So older people can spot the queen, and some of them just look good. So anyway, people asked me to make them available as prints, as posters. I did. People like them. So I'm putting a link down in the video description to my Teespring, which has those photos on there. And so when I come across other conditions, other close-ups and things like that, because we're going to do a lot of macro images that are actually really large, full frame, one-to-one macro images. So these will be added to the collection. So if there's anything that you see in there that you would like to get, use the same link and you'll find it. New images will be added for those who are teaching about bees, or you've got a classroom environment and you just want to put them on the walls, or your bee club or something like that. I just wanted to let you know that's one of the things I'm doing. And that's it. So I want to thank you for spending your time with me today. As we close out, I'll show some of those pictures with the music at the end. And I hope you get through these storms okay. If you're in my neck of the woods, we have potential for hail and damaging winds. So I'm going to be out there putting shipping straps on all the beehives, of course, to make sure that they're all going to be fine. And so I hope you have a fantastic weekend. And that if you need rain, I hope you get it. And if you're going to endure the storms that are coming, I hope you have no damage. Thanks for watching. Have a great weekend.